They've won Tonys and Oscars and Emmys and Grammys. There's no red carpet because they're home in their jammies. From Melrose Place to Broadway to Janeway and her crew, let Seth and James bring all the stars to you.
Hey, you.
They're entertaining everyone, so who's gonna grouse? Just sit right back and you'll hear some tales on Stars in the House.
Hello.
Hi, everyone.
I'm Seth, this is James, and you're watching Stars in the House, which we began mid-March to raise money for the Actors Fund. James, tell everybody what the Actors Fund is. It's for rich Broadway actors to get pools, decks.
No, you actually would not qualify if you were a rich Hollywood actor.
Yeah, all right. I said Broadway.
Or Broadway. Oh, I'm not paying attention to you.
You're tuning me out.
Seth, we've been doing this for like almost 200 episodes.
Why is the lighting still this horrible?
I think it looks good. What are you talking about?
There's a whole crypt creature. All right, go on.
Here's what doesn't look good. The fact that we have a stack of encyclopedias right there in between our shoulders.
Here's the problem. Like, I do my live concerts from here, and we have to stack up my laptop. I have to take rehearsal and then put the back away.
It's a constant back and forth. I'm saying, plugging the Ethernet into our desktop for this show, and then into
plugging
my
SiriusXM microphone into the laptop. It's so boring, but anyway, we're our own tech team.
So
I'm my own wife. I'm my own tech team.
That's the stack of encyclopedias in between us.
Okay, tell me
anyway,
what the Actors Fund is.
The Actors Fund is an organization that really is a human services organization that helps people in the entertainment industry across the country with everything from insurance needs to rent to utilities, medical bills, basically all of that stuff. Thus the title Human Services Organization.
And it's just for actors?
No, it's for everyone. In fact, we got some thank you letters here.
Anyone emails. That works in any That's aspect right. of the artistic community.
I applied for and received a grant from you today. I'm humbled. This is from someone who received one. I am humbled and very, very grateful for the support. I just wanted to email you to let you know how very much I appreciate the gift. And I will forever be thankful for you for it. I hope you are all remaining safe and healthy and continue to do so. All the best to you at the Actors Fund.
Okay, just a couple of things I want to just say on another note. First of all, the fabulous doctor from the Samuel J. Health Clinic is here. Dr. Jason Kinn. And if I see one more theater professional or anybody post, hey, does anybody have a doctor in New York? Every person that is in the artistic community.
It's such new pet peeve.
Drives me, you should go to the Samuel J. Friedman Clinic because it's all Mount Sinai doctors. And the more people that have insurance that go, the more they can help the people that don't have insurance. So stop looking for a doctor and go to the Samuel J. Friedman Clinic. It's not a clinic. It's a health center.
Yeah, health center.
Okay. The other thing is I have two comments. Yes. So looking forward to Seth's concert tomorrow. Are you ready for Sierra Boggess' concert tomorrow? The concert is on Sunday. So I'm just nervous that I see two comments.
Yeah, tomorrow it was going to be next to normal, but that's been rescheduled for a couple of weeks from now. But instead, it's going to be... That's right. Reunion of Alice Ripley and Emily Skinner.
Yeah, Sideshow. So next to normal is going to be mid-September now, September 15th, I think it is.
I think so, yeah.
Tomorrow, Sideshow leads. The other thing is, we have one more comment. Is the Actors Fund a misnomer? Yes, because it's not just actors. And the most important thing...
Well, I think you just passed the most important thing. The lighting is fine, Seth.
Actually, that's not the most important thing.
Oh.
My six-year-old daughter runs around all the time saying, anywho!
Oh, no!
My signature saying, anywho!
You know what? Yes. It's gonna get old.
I don't think so.
It's gonna
I think
get
it's
old.
Just catching on now. Hashtag anywho.
I do want to say what our new total is. I do have to put on the glasses for this. It's a little tiny print. We are up to, since March 16th, we are up to $452,965 raised from the Actors Fund. We're approaching $500,000, folks.
Just some donations from people like you. And how do you donate? I know you're axing yourself. Here's how you do it. You go to starsinthehouse.com and you donate. And then basically, once you make that donation, you're going to get a receipt. Forward that receipt ASAP to donations@starsinthehouse.com. And then we will read them out loud, like a telethon.
You can also text Fund 2020 to 56512. Seth, I think you always sort of forget that, even though it's on the bottom of the screen.
I can't remember those numbers.
It's just, is that what it is? It's not like the what the kids do with the texting.
No, the kids do this. Hashtag anywho.
Oh, no. Hey, Seth, we always forget. Go asking people to subscribe. We always forget that.
Right. So here's everything we want. Here's the things that are sort of important for us. First of all, subscribe to the YouTube channel, because the more subscribers we have, the more we can call, like, Melrose Place and Scandal Reunions and go, like, join us. We have all these great subscribers. So please just subscribe to Stars in the House right now on YouTube.
Right.
Then follow us as well. We're literally at Stars in the House. So Twitter, Facebook, just follow us, because, like we said, the more followers we have. And by the way, then you get notified, because we have some really big reunions coming up in September.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, I don't know how we're going to do that announcement, but we've already got basically half of September booked.
Because our 200th episode is coming up, so we had to kind of do a big blowout.
Yes.
You can also follow our opinions are our own, whatever they say. You can follow personal accounts where I'm a lot more opinionated, because I'm not a 501c3, so I'm allowed to say whatever the hell I want. So if you follow us on Twitter, Seth Rudetsky at James West NYC, uncomfortable
laughing. Dr. LaPook is on early to watch the Constitution song and he's laughing.
Well, you know what I'm talking about. And the other thing we want to say is, if you need help, you go to actorsfund.org. Right. If you are a person that lives in the United States, no matter who you are,
that's right.
Get theater 2020census.gov.
Oh my gosh, so important.
We have Black Theater United here every day.
In basically, the month of July.
Yeah, yeah, saying you have to go. And it hasn't changed. Like, don't be ADD style like me and put it off, like my AP English papers, and I always got like a C, and like that's why I was a piano major. Go right now to 2020census.gov and get it over with. It takes 10 minutes.
And the last thing before because it totally segues into our first guests. Who are our guests today, Seth?
We
actually have two different segments, but they're totally related because they're about social justice.
Well, we're focusing on artists that kind of use music for social justice. So of course we have Peter Shane and Johnny Butler, who wrote this really cool piece called The Constitution Song that Dr. LaPook told us about. And then we have Shaina Taub, who is she's written these amazing social justice songs, but she's also gone commercial and she's doing The Devil Wears Prada.
Yes.
So we're gonna do half Shallow, Give Me Some Scoop, and half How Do We Make Some Amazing Action Alerts. We're gonna do both.
Right.
What else?
The only other thing, because it does totally tie in
what
to
is
our
action
first,
alert?
Is, the action alert, yes, that's to help lobby your senator and your congressional representative to basically make sure the arts are included in the next stimulus bill. Well, which will happen at some point.
If you go to Stars in the House right now, there's an action alert. It takes 2 seconds to fill out. It goes right to representative, says the arts have to be in the stimulus bill.
But this is where I was going to say that it fits into our first guest in the Constitution song, because the Constitution song is about getting young people engaged.
Correct.
And voting and registering to vote. And pollhero.org, the Poll Hero Project, is also about young people, but it's about young people becoming poll workers, because as you know, many poll workers are traditionally senior citizens, and because of COVID-19, many very wisely will not be poll workers, but we still need them.
Yeah,
and
there's a major lack of poll workers.
Right, and so pollhero.org is one of several organizations, we love them, that are taking it upon themselves to organize and getting it together so young people will be poll workers.
Yeah, you can literally get a job and make money for the entire day working the polls. You can be a young person, make money, which young people really, really need. And also, you'll be helping democracy. So tell anybody that you know that's young.
Right.
Not us, pollhero.org.
All right, Seth, let's bring Peter and Johnny on.
All right, we have the fabulous Peter Shane and the fabulous Johnny Butler, songwriting team. Hi, guys.
Hi, guys.
So first of all, we always forget to warn people, we're on StreamYard, and it's this kind of platform where if anyone speaks at the same time, all the sound stops. So, like, if you want to speak, sort of take a gentle inhale and indicate. So I know you formed a band back in the 60s, and you have a lot of songs out. So your greatest hit. So talk about the Constitution song. How did it happen? Was it Peter that was the impetus or Johnny?
Well, hold on for a second, because we didn't do a proper intro here. Peter Shane,
yes.
You are a professor of law, right, at Ohio State University. Is that right?
Yes, the Ohio State University, as we like to say.
Okay, the Ohio State. And Johnny Butler, I hear you won a Grammy Award. You're a Grammy Award winning producer and composer. Is that correct?
That's correct. Yeah.
Okay. And I heard that you're an alumnus of Oberlin.
I saw that t-shirt and I was just about to ask, like, are you a fan or did you go there? Or
did you hear my piano chops? I obviously went to Oberlin. Yes. were you a trombone major?
Saxophone
major.
Yeah, jazz saxophone and classical composition.
Oh no.
I know.
My roommate was a classical composer and it was literally this. because it was all 20th century music. Did you write anything that was tonal? Go.
They pretty much don't let you do that there. They'll kick you out if you write something tonal.
Where did you live? Hold on, we have to catch up. Dorm are you in?
I was in South for 2 years. So then I was how about you?
I was in South, then I was in North, and then I was off campus. But you know, I know, but they have all these she new places now. It's no longer the dump that we went to back in the day.
Well, you went back to in the day.
It's what? Fancy. They have a fancy new jazz building. When I was there, we were in like a rundown gymnasium.
Jazz is the big deal at Oberlin. Mr. Margolis was my piano teacher for a while, and he was like the jazz cat.
Oh,
I'm just saying. All right, Peter, let's discuss law.
We got Ohio all around here representing. Yeah. All right, Peter Shane.
The important question, though, is if we all laugh at the same time, does the sound go off?
That is an important question. And sadly, yes. who is the impetus for the song? Peter, were you like just funking out to a beat and you started rapping?
No. So the way this started, actually, the person who started this appears in the video. You will see a gentleman wearing a green T-shirt. He does a kind of kickboxing move, and he says, "I'm a veteran and I vote." His name is Charles Gibson, and he is a physical trainer, and he's been working with me for like 10 years, and we're friends. And in summer of 2016, I had gone to see Hamilton for my birthday, and the whole family went. Through brilliant timing, it was exactly a week after Lin-Manuel left the cast. But be that as it may, it was a wonderful evening. And I saw Charles the following week, and I said, was telling him about it and recited a few lines. And he said, "You should do this." And I said, "What?"
Yeah.
And he said, "Well, you teach constitutional history, so you ought to write a rap about the Constitution that makes young people want to vote." And I thought that was an interesting, utterly random challenge to pull out of the air. But it did kind of stick in my head. And by fall of 2017, I had the first draft of the lyrics. But I have, let me just say that all of the musical talent on this show is represented in the two other screens. So I needed to find a collaborator. And, I asked around for, what I thought were likely suspects closer to home than New York at the moment, although I'm a Long Islander. And as like 2 years into the process, it finally occurred to me to mention this project to friends at something called the American Constitution Society. This is a network of progressive lawyers on whose board of directors I sit. Mm-hmm. And a couple of senior staff people are good friends, and I shared this idea with them. They said, we had somebody who interned in our office and is now a lawyer for the Lawyers Committee on Civil Rights Voting Project. But he was a professional jazz musician in New York for 10 years before that. And he went to Oberlin and he might know somebody. His name is Ryan Snow. And Ryan's buddy from Oberlin was this guy named Johnny Butler. And so I wrote to him, and Johnny has always made it sound like he wasn't completely weirded out by getting this email out of the blue. But Johnny, what did you really think when I sent you this this idea?
When you contacted me, my first thought was like, what side of the law is this guy on? Like, is this guy a constitutionalist or is this guy a federalist? And that was literally the first question I asked you. Because if you had said federalist, I would have been like, there's no way I'm going to do this. But you're like, I met your friend through this constitutionalist society. That was kind of my thinking.
And then, right. Peter, you these lyrics you wrote actually rhyme. You basically wrote like a poem, right?
I did. And, as I said, the idea kind of stuck in my mind for a long time without progress. And then, actually, it may have been listening to the Hamilton album that made me think, Independence and Descendants. Huh. And I thought of the Constitution as a solution, and it just went from there. And I want to say, and I'm sure you've arranged it this way, this is not the first time a song of mine has been performed in this, on television. It happened 50 years ago when I was 18. There's been a hiatus in my songwriting career.
What song?
it's not really a hit. It was called Going On, and if you are back in the 60s and early 70s, there was a thing called the Herald Tribune World Youth Forum that would bring European kids to the U.S. and send us over there to effect rapprochement. And while I was in Dubrovnik, that summer of 1970, this lyric occurred to me. A friend of mine in the group wrote the music to it, and they were so thrilled with it that they actually allowed somebody with a wonderful voice who was also traveling with us to perform it on television. And that was probably in August of 1970, so literally 50 years ago.
So you write song, you do like every 50 years you come out with a song.
So the thing is, so basically I'm like Bernie Taupin without connections. You know, I walk around with bags of lyrics hoping to meet Elton John, and so far, not so much. Until I met Johnny.
Yeah, so Johnny, so what did you do for it? You added that the sassy drum track and then all the riffs, the brass riffs?
When Peter first sent me, well, first he sent me the lyric like written down, and I asked him if he had had any recordings of him like maybe rapping it or speaking it to somebody. And he sent me a recording of him reading it to a class. And you just told me, Peter, it was like for, I think, the first day. Was that right, of class?
No, it was the first year of class. But they were, it was kind of a low-energy day. It was a makeup class. Huh. And I said, do you mind interrupting your legal education for 10 minutes? Because I want to tell you about a project. And somebody in the back said, make it 15. So yes, I recited the song. I had them participate, and I got a standing ovation, which is how I knew that this was this had legs.
Peter, let me ask you: if you're around, because you're a teacher, right?
Yes.
So what's professor. The average? What's a professor? What's the average age of your student? Would you say in their early 20s?
Early to mid 20s. Although Ohio State, like a lot of public universities, has a certain number of has a significant number of older students. Ohio State has a lot of students who are serving or have served in the military. And more we have people who have, you know, done things between college and law school. A lot of nurses, a lot of social workers, a lot of people who realize that their ability to help people is curtailed if they do not understand and can act upon the law. So, and those are, of course, some of the most interesting students.
But was part of your reason for, because the purpose of the Constitution song is to get young people engaged, right? Registering to vote, voting. So were you seeing in your students an apathy? I'm just curious, like what sparked, there were a lot of different things you could have written about, or, you know, why this?
Well, you know, one of my motivations is I didn't want my physical trainer to get angry with me. So, you know, he said, target youth, so I targeted youth. But more seriously, there are two things. Actually, most of my students, or a lot of my students, I think, are quite engaged. But if you look at the history of, you know, even presidential elections, the percentage of youth turnout is not impressive. Right. And, you know, if you believe a great teacher of mine once said, you know, the world has many you know, old Turks and young fogies. And what he meant by that is, you know, sometimes there are people, you know, progressive people my age who identify more with the progressives of a much younger generation. And in my case, those are the people I wanted to reach. And I want them to build voting into their sense of identity. I mean, people don't vote because, you know, there's an immediate payoff. You vote because you think of yourself as a person who votes. That's what citizens of a democracy do. So it was really, you know, seeing what has happened in past elections with young people, you know, staying out on the assumption that it doesn't make a difference, or, you know, one vote doesn't count, or, you know, for some reason this politics isn't for them. That's just such a huge mistake. And if you believe, as I do, that the younger generation, younger generations still have as much or more to say about everything that we should be hearing. This is a tragedy. And so that's what I was trying to do.
And Johnny, for you, was that part of your, what was your attraction to doing this? Because it's a great song, but we're going to show the video in a few minutes. But I mean, it's a lot of work. I mean, what sparked your interest?
You know, for me, it's been kind of like a long sort of ongoing process. Like as we were developing this more and bringing more musicians and dancers and artists into it, and sort of like kind of focusing around like really getting people active, engaged in the voting process, registering to vote. Like it started feeling like more and more important as we went. I think at first, like my main thing was like, let's make this as good as possible. And then at a certain point, it was like, wow, actually, like, I'm going to put extra time into this because I want this to really be able to, like, resonate with people. Because I think the thing that's particularly special about what we made is the kind of, like, joy of it, or, like, the effusive energy. I don't even know how to say it. I mean, there's so many brilliant artists that contributed their time and energy to this. It just explodes with it. Like, you can't watch it and not feel this kind of like uplifting energy. Even though we filmed it like during quarantine, you know, and finished a lot of the process during quarantine. So I think like when people see it, you know, they see this piece that was made now that is like full of optimism and full of hope. And all these people who are like over here doing their thing, like together for this purpose. I think like the response we've gotten has been, you know, when people see it, they always say, like, I was feeling kind of down. I've been working for the election, but it's like, I feel kind of like I'm grinding down on it. Yeah. And then I watched your video and I feel so much better. Like, I feel so inspired. Like, this is exactly what we need.
Well, on that note then, Johnny, let's watch it. Now, here's the thing. StreamYard, it used to be when we first started in March, you only had 30 seconds, which would have made this
for a video,
which would have made this very challenging. We'd have had so many, but this is a little bit longer than 5 minutes. So we're going to kind of quickly, when we go from part one to part two, we're going to switch and then we'll talk for a few minutes. But it is, you can find out more information and the whole video uninterrupted at theconstitutionsong.org.
Theconstitutionsong.org.
That's right. So hit it, Seth.
So here we go.
Great.
Hi, everybody.
That didn't guarantee a country fit for their descendants.
The states at first agreed to just a loose confederation. They didn't have the unity it takes to forge a nation.
So 4 years after wartime, Philly saw a secret meeting of men who knew without a change their freedom would be fleeting.
Their government was feeble. It needed a solution. In 16 weeks, they hammered out a U.S. Constitution.
Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice to the Constitution song.
The drafters feared their wobbly league of states would lead to ruin. From now on, we the people must be joined in perfect union.
Such a bold experiment, they had to take some chances. They built a federal system and a structure with three branches.
A Congress to enact the laws, the courts to judge correctly. A president takes care that laws are carried out directly.
A lot of it was brilliant, but some of it was knavery. To get the southern states to join, the draft protected slavery.
Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice. To the Constitution song.
The states had varied interests. Their differences were vast. But delegates agreed they had to get a charter passed. Some states signed on with promises there'd soon be some amendments. The Bill of Rights brought 10 of these. Their impact is tremendous.
We have free speech, a robust press, the right to pray or not. Limits on police power, but not on private thought.
Success was never certain, despite the revolution. took 10 months to ratify the U.S. Constitution.
Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice to the Constitution song. Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice to the Constitution song.
From bondage, thousands tried to flee. We still salute their bravery. 620,000 soldiers died because of slavery.
The Civil War amendments, they finally set a new direction, by promising due process and for everyone equal protection.
But women didn't get the right to vote till 1920. The times are still a-changing, and the challenges still plenty.
No government is perfect. We still need new solutions to live up to the promise of the U.S. Constitution.
Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice to the Constitution song.
Now some will try to fool you, say the Constitution's static, just like a piece of parchment getting dusty in the attic.
For every generation, it gets to fight for new improvements. We have this Constitution that was built on protest movements.
Sometimes the people change the text, sometimes interpretation. But either way, a change can come when justice moves the nation.
Ningún gobierno es perfecto, somos la solución. Para cumplir con la promesa de la Constitución.
Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice to the Constitution song.
Our founding generation thought the king was a disaster. They fought to make a country where the people would be master.
So if you think your country it isn't acting as it should be, just register and vote to make your country what it could be.
Seize your part in history and make a resolution. Together, let's give meaning to the U.S. Constitution.
Their government was feeble. It needed a solution. And now we get to build upon the U.S. Constitution.
Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice to the Constitution song.
One vote can make a difference.
Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice to the Constitution song.
Stand up for your convictions.
Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice to the Constitution song.
You're part of We the People.
Add your voice. Add your voice. Add your voice to the Constitution song.
Add your voice.
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 Add your voice to the Constitution song.
That is so good.
Thanks, guys.
Johnny, I loved your arabesque while playing the sax.
Oh, yes. The rooftop arabesque. Yeah.
Could have turned out a little bit more, but I still improved.
I could have gotten a little more like attitude to the front, maybe, or a little.
Next time. Next Constitution song.
Well, besides going, I'm going to put the website up, though it's super easy, theconstitutionsong.org. But when I was looking at it, one of the really cool things was this. I'm going to get this wrong, so I'm going to have you explain it. It's not that it's not copyrighted, but basically people can use it for free. Can you explain that?
Sure. So there is a thing, an organization is actually created by a guy named Larry Lessig, who is another law professor. He teaches at Harvard, called Creative Commons. And his idea was, copyright is great. It has a lot of important functions, but a lot of people would actually be happy to see other people be able to use their work as long as it gets credited. And, this is not a commercial venture for Johnny and me. So, we don't really want other people to make money off it and not share it. But if other people are willing to do nonprofit things with it in order to stir civic engagement and promote, you know, people voting or becoming poll workers, then we would be delighted for that to happen. And we were eager to share it. So we have this, what we call a Creative Commons license that allows that.
Okay. Okay.
So that's for TikTok, especially people. And we want to just take our medical break with the person that brought.
That's right. Who brought the Constitution song to us, our good friend, Dr. John LaPook.
A medical break and our Constitution song man. Thank you, Dr. John LaPook.
Hey, guys. Hello, Peter. Hi, Johnny.
Hey, John.
I have to give you a little backstory here because Peter is pretty modest guy. So I've only known him for 54 years. We met when I was in seventh grade. Forget about the fact that he was, cover your ears, Peter, by far the smartest guy in our school. Went to Harvard for college and always top of his class, went to Yale for law school. Forget about all that. What I'm seeing here is so amazing because he is cut from the same cloth now that he was cut back in seventh grade. Peter, what grade were you in when you wrote a constitution for West Hempstead? Was it junior high school or senior?
Oh, wait a minute. First of all, I had cultivated my constitution writing arts, writing a constitution first for the eighth grade. And then, only then, did I have the confidence to move on to the junior and senior high school student council.
I didn't know any of this. This is just,
it was with that in mind that I invented the move. I copyrighted that move. But yeah. Peter, you know, Peter is too modest, but he's a major constitutional expert. He's a big guy in law and brilliant and, you know, one of my best friends. The friend I've known the longest in my life.
Well, this is very kind of you, but I want to say, you know, if I really screw up in class, you know, somebody who should have been inspired is bored. John, if you screw up, somebody dies. So I'm going to give you a lot
not
more.
When I'm on Stars in the House, they don't die. Maybe die in the showbiz sense.
Exactly. You lose a laugh.
You know, we have total different vernacular. We never say in medicine, "I killed." You know, but
we do.
You guys. Right, in the theater, isn't that an expression? All right.
John and I commiserate. All right, speaking of Dr. John LaPook, what is the new thing I keep reading? Like, people keep getting reinfected. Everyone's having a panic attack. The hell is that about?
You know, I'm looking at that article, the case in Nevada. I'm looking at it tonight. It is in the Lancet. It is not a peer-reviewed article yet. And this is one of the things that worries and has worried a lot of us. I'm not saying one way or the other about the authenticity of it and whether it's going to end up being valid. But it's like drinking from a fire hydrant right now. I mean, we have all these papers because there's a reason for peer review. And we've already had retractions from The Lancet, from New England Journal, big, big journals in the rush to be the first to get it all out there. So I'm going to hold off on that. If it's happening, it doesn't seem to be happening a lot. And there have been these false positives because remember the PCR test that's looking for genetic material, RNA, well, you could have beaten it and still have blown up pieces of RNA in your nose up to 82 days after being infected, after symptoms. So, but nobody's shown that they can infect past 10 days after the beginning of symptoms. So we have to be very careful. In this case, they claim there's a little bit of a genetic difference between the two strains. The person is a young guy, reinfected. I got to take a look at it. But the thing that's bothering me right now, we did a story on CBS this morning today about the fact that it looks like the CDC changed their recommendation. They were saying, and it was a backbone of this whole pandemic, that you know if you're exposed to somebody with COVID-19, even if you're asymptomatic, you get tested because we want to make sure that you're not brewing it and starting to shed asymptomatically without symptoms and infecting many other people before that first person who infected you even knows that they're positive, because we know there's delays before they even know. Well, the CDC changed their advice and saying you no longer have to get tested. You still have to quarantine for the 14 days, but There was a big uproar about this. They changed it. They amended it to say, well, you can consider it with your doctor. But my sources told me that people at the CDC were actually against this advice change, and there's pressure from Health and Human Services. And so what this all says, and Peter, you're somebody who knows a lot about this. You know, there's been a tradition of, you know, the CDC, it's their thing. They say what they're going to say, and, you know, you hope that they're an independent organization. Same thing with the FDA. And we're starting to see. We've been seeing politicization, turning these decisions into a political issue. And that's the last thing we need at a time when there's going to be a vaccine coming out, and there are already people who are vaccine hesitant or anti-vaccine, and you don't want to add to that the thought that, well, maybe a vaccine, which is going to be coming down the line fairly soon, we hope, that there's any kind of politics involved in getting it okayed sooner, and instead of having, say, a full FDA authorization, that it's going to be done under an emergency use authorization, which is sort of a way around doing the formal authorization. So this is something that is really upsetting a lot of people. I know this may be boring for a lot of the viewers, but this is something that is making my colleagues apoplectic, the thought that this whole process is being politicized.
Right.
Oh, God. All right. Well, the end of the story is, if you think you've been exposed, get tested. There's nothing wrong with getting tested.
Well, here's the thing. Remember, 2 to 14 day incubation period. If you think you've been exposed, if you know, it turns out you were exposed to somebody, you got to be quarantined for 14 days, period, because you could get tested every day and be negative up until day 14. So you don't want to be out and around spreading it. And we know that you can start spreading it 2 to 3 days before you have symptoms. So you can't rely on symptoms. That's why we changed the advice and said masks for everybody. But so you got to be quarantined. But on top of that, you need to be tested, because if you are positive, then all the people you've been in contact with, it's the bread and butter of taking care of epidemics, is what epidemiology does. You find out who was infected. You find out who their contacts are. You contact their contacts. You test them. Okay, if they're infected, you quarantine them. Find out who their contacts were. Goes out in rings. And you got to do that. There's no two ways around it. So there have been some suggestion that the reason why there was some political pressure, I mean, who knows exactly why, but there's been a lot of complaint. You've heard it said that if we stop doing so much testing, we won't have as many cases. That's like, if I close my eyes, the boogeyman will go away. No, the boogeyman's still there. My eyes are closed. You know? So you got to know, you still got to do the testing. And one of the things that some people have said is wondering whether this pressure was to just have fewer documented cases. I don't know at all if that's true, but it doesn't take a big imagination to think that people might think that. Did I say that politically enough, Peter?
That was
perfect.
All right, so in conclusion, constitutionsong.org.
That's right.
Get a test if you've been exposed, and wear a mask basically wherever you are.
That's right.
Thank you to all three of you guys.
And we'll see you tomorrow, Dr. LaBrook. Peter and Johnny, thank you so much.
Tomorrow, Peter, Johnny, nice to meet you.
Thank you, guys.
Good job.
And now let's go to our other
social
justice songster, the amazing Shaina Taub.
Shaina.
Hey, guys.
Hi.
And I'm going to bring on one of your current stars from your upcoming Broadway, or as my mother says, Broadway musical, Taylor Iman Jones. Hi, Taylor.
Hi.
Hi. Your makeup looks amazing.
Oh, thank you. I've been watching a lot of tutorials lately. So
I got it. You have
to get in there.
Really, highlighter? Because Julie uses highlighter. I'm obsessed with it.
Yes, 100%.
Okay, get back to me. Stunning. Okay, so we're going to talk Devil Wears Prada in just a moment. Shaina Taub, when did you decide? I feel like so many of your songs are so social justice oriented. How did you get interested in that type of thing?
It's just always been something I've been drawn to. Like I held like a teach-in in fifth grade against the Iraq War. It's just always been, I don't know. It's one of those things that's just kind of been a part of what I've loved. And I mean, even growing up, like in rural Vermont around musical theater, like the musicals that I first loved, like had a social justice bent to them. Like I was so obsessed with Ragtime as a kid, or even I like remember learning about the Nazis through being in Cabaret. Like it was just, I don't know. And I come from Vermont, and there's a big social justice scene there. So that was part of it too.
But how do you sort of balance the didactic boringness of social justice, you know, with making an entertaining song?
I mean, I think it's finding the humanity in it. You know, like the, I'm going to play a song a little later called Where Are the Grownups? That's about, it's just finding a way to like take an issue and humanize it and put it in a story and using the tools. I mean, you know, we have just before we have like the scientists and the doctors who can give us the facts and figures, but we can give the heart and mind stories, you know? So I think it's just like trying to find that balance. Yeah.
You were in our Concert for America that my husband and I, James, did for National Immigration Law Center, and you sang this great song. I'm going to play a clip from it. This is the, is it called Lady Liberty, Lady with the Torch? What's it called?
Oh, Huddled Masses. Close.
But it is about, it is about her, though. Not close at all. No, wait, why did you write it? Were you, like, commissioned to write it, or you just see the Statue of Liberty one day, and you're like, I'm writing it?
It was actually, I mean, it's a song I'd always meant to write and had the sort of three-chapter structure for. And it was actually inspired by columns by Nicholas Kristof, who's a New York Times columnist. And he has a column, you know, maybe from, it was even pre-2016, of like Anne Frank was a little Syrian girl, just kind of drawing the parallels between Anne Frank's story and refugees in Syria. And then he has another one called like the Statue of Liberty is Crying in Shame, and just about how the Jesus story is a refugee story. And so I always kind of had this three chapter structure of taking, you know, Jesus' story is a refugee story, Anne Frank's story is a refugee story, and then the story of a contemporary, you know, immigrant from Syria, so to speak, and kind of using the Emma Lazarus poem as the connective tissue. And that was tough in terms of the didactic balance, because you don't want to be preachy. Like, I remember that song used to have a pre-chorus that was exactly what you're saying, that was like, Lady Liberty must be crying in shame. And it just always felt, it was too much. Like, when you have a song that has, like, Jesus and Frank and Give Me Your Tired, Your Poor, like, just let that sit. So that song, like, form-wise, it's like verse, chorus, verse, chorus, verse, chorus. That's it. And, like, let the words and the gravity of those, of the words and the characters of Jesus and Anne Frank speak for themselves. And also taking, now I have all the answers, not all the answers, but now I have things I want to say. Taking the I out of it. Sometimes, like when I'm doing a song like Huddled Masses, there's not an I. It's like, there once was a little boy, there once was a little girl, give me your tired or poor. Like, there's myself, I'm not a character, which I think takes the preachiness out. It's just sort of that like omniscient voice. But anyway, yeah, so I'd always had that idea and was always a little daunted by writing it. But then right after the inauguration in 2017, like the weekend of the airport protests around the first constitutional, speaking of constitution, Muslim ban, I was like, if I'm not going to write it now, like this is the moment, you know?
It came out so great. Here's just a little clip of it.
Do give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses on the demon shore, yearning to breathe free. Send them all to me. Welcome all Muslims, Christians, Jews, and more. Every child fleeing hate and war. I lift my lamp beside the golden door, and I'll forever lift my lamp beside the golden door.
So great. Now, you don't mean the Golden Door Spa, do you? Anybody know the Golden Door Spa?
How do you know this?
So nah. Shallow. Oh, wait, someone just wrote, I love that song. Thank you for it. Anyway, so Taylor, the first time I saw you was in Head Over Heels, but that wasn't your first Broadway show, was it?
No, I made my debut in Groundhog Day.
Wait, were you opposite Andy?
No, I understudied her though. We called her Beach Ball Girl because I just had a beach ball the whole show that I danced around with.
Wait, how annoying was that?
You know, it was a lot, especially once the winter gloves came in. Like, we had to make me special football mittens to hold on to. But no, it was fine. It became my little best friend. I have it still. Yeah.
Okay. I love that you got the underside of the lead. Did you ever get to go on for the lead?
I did, which then I was opposite Andy for a few shows, which is just an incredible learning experience. I mean, he was so good in that show. So
yeah.
To like be face to face was unreal.
How scary was it going on for the first time for a lead role as an understudy?
I mean, I think anybody who's ever been an understudy will tell you the first time you just like black out and don't remember anything. Especially with Groundhog Day, we had all those turntables. So specifically with that show, it was just like I was in a whole different show because I had no idea where the literal stage was. But scary, exciting. The second time is more fun because then you actually can remember what you're doing.
Although a lot of people say that you have second show slump because you're so focused the first time. And the second time you relax and you're like, I forgot my line.
Well, that's the people who relax. If you're, you can never relax if you're an understudy. That's number one.
I like your sass.
You were so good in Head Over Heels. It was one of our favorite
musicals. We love that show so much.
You were so good. The whole cast was amazing.
And the staging, who did that amazing choreography? He was so good. Spencer Liff. Oh, my God. Here's just the opening number with your solo. But it's one of those shows, like, I love so much because you hear the expression, but the tone is set immediately at the beginning. It's so well done that you completely get the tone of the show. And that really has a lot to do with Spencer. It just was brilliantly staged right at the beginning. And your solo is fabulous. Here we go.
That's so great.
Oh my gosh. It's so exciting, man. I just love it. So
closing weekend. I saw Head Over Heels on closing weekend. We were like, oh no, we waited till last minute. And it was I'm so glad we went on closing weekend because it was just the crowd was wild. It was amazing.
We saw opening night. So it's kind of the same energy.
Yeah.
The closing night when that first drum beat started, kunk, 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 the audience was so loud. When the curtain came up, I couldn't hear any of the music at all. It completely drowned it out. And I remember just thinking like, just start singing. And I messed up the words to the opening number that I sang 8 times a week. I completely swapped lyrics, but I was like, whatever. It's so cool.
You're one of those people who loses focus also, Taylor. Busted.
Okay, you know, I will take that. Busted.
Final show slump, that's called. Okay, so Shaina talks. So I know, like, basically, like, it's sort of the early stages of Devil Wears Prada. But, like, Taylor, what was your process? Because you played the role played by, I can't remember anybody's movie star's name. What was your name in the movie? I mean,
Anne Hathaway.
Anne Hathaway. Who just got cast, did you read, in Dear Evan Hansen? The movie.
Oh, I did not see that yet.
Today, playing the Jennifer Laura Thompson part.
Oh.
She just got cast.
Oh, yeah. Okay, she's going to be heartbreaking. Great. Okay.
Thank you. So wait, so you're playing that role. So how did you have auditions, or did Elton John just call you and say, hello?
Oh yeah, we go way back. So he was just like, "You, what are you doing?" No, yes, there are many rounds of auditions, and I'm sure more than even I'm aware of on Shaina's side. But there, I know I went through at least 4 rounds. Of round after round after round, and then like they were like, okay, it's your final callback, and then they're like, just kidding, here's another final callback. So you know, it was very scary. And then the most daunting part outside of the audition itself was I probably waited almost 3 weeks until I got the like, it's your part. It wasn't until the press release went out that even I was like, okay, I didn't make it up. It like, you know, this is at least it's out there for people to see now. But it was really exciting. I will say, I know stakes were high, but it was one of the most supportive rooms I've ever been in, including Shaina. Like the smile on everyone's faces as you performed was glorious. And I could tell that that wasn't like just for me. I could tell that it was just who everyone in the room was as people. They were rooting for you the whole time. And that was just really cool.
Shaina, were you working on Devil Wears Prada when you saw Taylor in Head Over Heels?
What years are years? When did that close in 2019?
Like January 2019. So it's more, it's like 2 years ago. Yeah.
I'm a huge fan of Taylor's, and I was just so excited when she came in the room. She was so amazing. I mean, I was telling you, Seth, it's like I'm just so, our real process was about to kick off literally like 2 days after everything shut down. We were all going to fly to Chicago and have a workshop. I was so excited to like really get in, and we were gonna have a workshop this summer, you know, like kind of everything else. So I'm just like chomping at the bit for when we can finally get in the room that's beyond the audition room, like get in the rehearsal room and really get down to work.
So people don't know, Paul Rudnick is writing the book, the hilarious Paul Rudnick, and Elton John's writing the music, and Shaina is writing the lyrics. But again, how does one get the job? Did Elton John, Shaina, call you and say, hello?
He did, yeah. He did.
And did you say, blimey?
Well, it was crazy. I like, you know, sent in my audition, like, you know, I wrote spec songs and all that. And yeah, he called me up. And he was so, I have said this from the moment I spoke with him on the phone and met him, he's just like such a mensch. He really is. He's been like nothing but the kindest, like loveliest man. And he called me like just so kind. And he was like, it's Elton. Like I talked to him every day, you know? And we were like talking about the weather that day. And I was like, it was surreal, but he was so nice. And he's like, I'm so excited. Let's hit the ground running. And it was amazing. It was really surreal. And kind of like, until it was like, you know, I called my mom, I called my best friends, I told my husband, it wasn't until I think you sort of live in that fear as an artist. I don't know. It's like, you kind of need something confirmed for you. When the news was bad, I was like, all right, that means I'm really doing it. Oh shit. Now I really have to do it. I don't like that, you know? But
I just want to take a break to just say that I constantly do this all the time. I see a letter and I think it's the same name. So yesterday on the show, I was like, Nathan Lane played nicely. And Nathan Lane played Nathan Detroit. Anyway, I got a text immediately from Barrett Foe being like, he did not play nicely, played Nathan. So of course everyone is like, Seth, it's Amy Adams, not Anne Hathaway and Dear Hansen. So that's my signature. I saw an A and I was like, there's only one person with an A. So everyone's commenting.
She'll still be heartbreaking.
There you go.
Just want to clear that up with people. Okay, so hold up, but Taylor, let me understand something. When you were auditioning, had there not been were you auditioning for the reading, the workshop, or the Broadway show, or was everything just one thing?
I guess at that point it was for all things. It was for workshop and out of town and going to Broadway was, you know, what everybody wants it. That's what the thing is. So like it was so unreal. Like it's one of those audition sides you get and you're like, okay, cool. I guess I'll go in for this because why not? But obviously they'll go, you know, I always say they'll go get Kiki Palmer to do it. Cause we look so much alike, but in that regard, it kind of gave me freedom to just be me and do it how I want. I know I'm not Anne Hathaway. I know we're very different people. And if they were calling me in, then I know they're already not looking for Anne Hathaway to do it. So it allowed me to do what I want. And I think the room was really open and responsive to that. Even as far as the other people I could see going in, they really wanted us to play. And so the more rounds of callbacks I kept getting, I was like, I guess I'm doing something right. And I'll just keep being out there and like myself.
That's great. You don't have to fit into a mold. A lot of times people like get the movie and they try to recreate what they saw. So it's great that you were just like, I'm just going to do it my own way.
Might as well.
We had Beauty and the Beast on a couple nights ago, and Susan Egan was saying that they made Terrence Mann wear a lift in his shoes for the poster because they thought the Beast and Belle had to have the exact same proportions as the cartoon Beast and Belle. They were so panicked. Disney was like, people want to see exactly what the movie is, because that was their first thing ever, was right. That, you know? So hold on, I have to ask something. Shaina, you're so multitasking. You're also working on another musical about suffragettes that I feel all my Belcher friends are in. So what is that?
As a cast of all women, yeah. It's so funny because I think people are like, wow, your projects are so different, but they actually feel so similar to me because they both have this same central relationship of like this intergenerational conflict between two women, kind of over power and ambition and different styles of how to achieve goals. And so it's sort of been amazing to work on one that's like a period piece from 100 years ago and one that's uber contemporary. But
and what's it, are you writing music and lyrics?
That one, I'm writing the whole thing. I'm just going for it. But it's sung through. It's like, it's a big, huge show, all sung all the way through. And so it's also fun to kind of be working on two different things with completely different roles. Like one, it's really all on me and I craft, you know, I outlined it, I did it's every element. And then one where I'm sort of one piece of a puzzle. Mm-hmm. Writing brain to not be coming at things musically. It's been great.
Are you going to Willam Wellett and starring it too?
What's that?
Are you going to Lin-Manuel it and star in it too?
I'm going to star in it. Yeah. Because yes, I was a performer first. And I'm like, well, yeah, that's to me. That's like the sort of prize. That's like the piece of cake I get to eat if I complete the diet of writing the show. You know
what I mean? I love it. I have this great, beautiful song with such great harmony. I guess you did kind of like a Zoom version of it, like a Zoom version of the song recently. Or like
we did this sort of New York Times event we did around, we would be starting rehearsals right now with the public. So we sort of did a little event to digitally commemorate that. Yeah.
I love it. Here, listen how great it sounds, everyone. It's called Suffragists. What's it called?
Suffragist. Yeah.
Suffragist. Here we go.
She went into trial, a laugh on her lips.
She once told me discouragement only excited her.
So brilliant a speaker, we can't afford to lose.
She belongs to life,
to the struggling actuality of the earth.
I used to wish
I could be in her shoes, with her voice ringing out the centuries seem like repetitions of an ancient song.
So pretty.
Beautiful.
We're applauding me. just FYI, we're going to do special guest surprise. We always like to have surprise guests. And Bonnie Milligan was going to be our surprise guest tonight. Because I know that she did one reading of Suffragist. And Taylor, she's your really good pal, but she literally the last second cannot make it. But I found this really fun clip of you guys doing a sing-off and also a belt-off. And if you don't know, Bonnie starred opposite. And they basically played, they wound up being each other's love interests. And head over heels. Yes,
I love her so much.
So do we. Oh my god.
She is so incredible, as we all know, as a performer, but just having been opposite her 8 times a week, she is one of the most consistent professionals I have ever worked with. And talk about a comedian. Like, she has the most incredible timing I've ever seen. Oh my god, yeah, it was just a pleasure. And that was Broadway Con. We accidentally both chose the same song to sing, and we didn't know, and so they surprised us with that, and so it was really
fun. Oh my god, it's so good. Right. Yeah, Bonnie is brilliant. All right, so Shaina, before you go, I'm so excited. You brought your sawhorse. I don't even know what the squeeze box, whatever you want to call it.
No, it's the sawhorse. You were correct.
I am correct. No. I love this name dropping.
Amy Adams in Hathaway. It's all, who knows? Oh, yeah.
I am the worst. So wait, what is this song? Where is it from?
This is a song from an album I released in 2018 called Die Happy. And I wrote it like in the aftermath of the inauguration. But I feel like if I were playing this tonight in a live show, I would say this is my response to last night's RNC.
Bully has taken the playground. The smallest start trembling in fear. Everyone's yelling and shoving, and I'm standing here. Waiting for them to come running. Aren't they supposed to arrive? Where are the grown-ups to save the day? Where are the grown-ups to make it okay? Somebody's gotta come clean this mess off the floor. Where are the grown-ups we've been waiting for? Where I thought they'd be here by now. Where are the grown-ups to save the day? Where are the grown-ups to show us the way? Somebody's gotta come clean this mess off the floor. Where are the grown-ups we've been waiting for? Where are the grown-ups? Stop crying. She's scared of the man on TV. Little eyes widen with worry. She turns to me. She's looking around for an answer. And now I have mine. We are the grown-ups to save the day. We are the grown-ups to show us the way. We're not gonna take this bully shit anymore. We are the grown-ups we've been waiting for. My God, we are the grown-ups. We are the grown-ups. So what are we waiting for?
Yay!
I love the placement of the last note. Four! Just had a
placement. I know this. Oh, don't put it against a piano. It will not do well.
No.
I got this back in the tent doing Natasha and Pierre, and it has withstood a lot of elements. So it
a lot of humidity.
I like deeply need a new accordion. It's definitely a good quarter tone off.
It's A439. For you musicians out there.
Shaina and Taylor, thank you so much for coming on tonight. This is so fun.
Yeah, it's so fun,
it's
guys.
It's so meaningful, especially after, you know, all the events of 2020. And as you said, the last week and the 2 weeks, and it's a great way to end it.
And Taylor, we want to do a Head Over Heels reunion show on Stars in the House.
Oh my gosh.
Everybody.
Yeah.
That would be amazing.
That would be amazing. And Shaina, I just have to say, it's so cool to like finally get to talk with you. This is kind of the first time we've really been able to speak at all. And I've been a fan of yours since Old Hats that you did at ACT. I was training there. Yeah, I was training there at the time. So we saw it like as part of our curriculum. And I remember like the show itself was incredible. The clowning was amazing, but then your scoring over it was just so perfect. I remember like coming to you after the show and being like, you don't know me and blah, 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 but you're so good. And I think you gave me like your email or something. It was just, you were so lovely then. And so I'm just so excited. I'm so excited.
Thank you so much, Taylor. I'm so pumped to work with you. I like couldn't like, I just can't wait until we can finally get in the room together. It's gonna be so fun. Right.
Well, FYI, Beth Lovell wanted to join you guys too, but I don't know if I announced it yet, but she just moved and her Wi-Fi is not set up yet. So we would have had Miranda and her young charge. Anywho, guys, thank you so much. We're gonna play our little exit end credits. What should I play?
What
I don't know.
Something from Head Over Heels.
No, I was gonna do for Shaina. I'll do.
Oh, good.
The show she liked in high school.
Oh, good. Okay, good.
Has to remember.
Okay.
Bye. I know one bath.